You're just in love with Cordelia. James was horrified, and this is how I imagine him. I am fond of her. Like, he's not in love.
Hello everyone, my name is Vinish, and today we are going to reread Chain of Gold. So, of course, there are going to be spoilers regarding Chain of Gold. There are also a few stories that connect to the characters that are in Chain of Gold so that you get a better understanding of them or their background. So, if you want to know about them, I will leave all the details about those stories. There are not many. I will write them all down in the description. I just don't want to waste time talking about that, but just know there are going to be spoilers for the Infernal Vices. So if you are planning on reading that, don't start with Chain of Gold because you are going to be spoiled for a lot of things that happen in that those books. Also, you can start the Shadowhunter Chronicles with whichever book you like. There are a lot of orders, but do not, I suggest, start with Chain of Gold because one thing, it will spoil you for the Infernal Vices. Second thing, that there are so many characters, siblings, relatives, so many that you will not understand who is who belongs to who is related to who. It will take a lot of time for you to understand. And then there are some things that characters go through and you don't know why they're going through it. So those things are explained in the other stories. But it's not like you have to read those stories before this one, because I, for one, read those stories after Chain of Gold last year. So no worries, but just don't start with Chain of Gold is my suggestion. That's it. We are going to start the book now. Sorry, just editing. You can read from Chain of Gold. All you have to read before Chain of Gold in order to understand things better is The Penultimate Hours. I will share the cover over here. And the short stories that connect to the Last Hour characters, like Matthew Fairchild, James Herentil, and Eli Wood, I would name them in the description bar below. So check it out. So first of all, it's raining and it's very gloomy inside. So I'm sitting here right in front of the balcony and reading. And I know many people have done this before, but I wanted to do it too. And here, I wanted to admire this cover because I love the cover of Chain of Iron, but this just has its own level of beauty. And I love it because this is the first ever book that I pre-ordered in life. I also love it because it's collector's edition. And because of this. This is the first book I got which had any illustrations in it. So I love it. Love it very, very much. Okay, part one. So Hafsa, one of my buddy reader friends, told me that there is Chain of Iron or Gold or Thorns or Flowers, and she's like, we get gold, iron and thorns, but we are flowers. So I am thinking that the flowers are going to be the epilogue and Chain of Thorns, because Cassie always writes amazing epic epilogues. But the flowers could also be a novella, and it just can be that it's a trilogy. So maybe Cassie just cut off flowers. It can be that. Whenever I read a Shadowhunter book, it feels so much like I'm home. Okay, that's too much for a fictional world, but I really love it. And especially the historical times that Cassie writes, The Infernal Devices and Chain of Gold, it's amazing. I love it. So I forgot that it was Polly the werewolf who gave them the name Merry Thieves. I love the name Merry Thieves for all of them, and I love all four of them so much. It's just, I'm a sucker for friendships, and these boys have a really pure, strong, platonic relationship. It's fantastic. I love reading about it. James met me cheered upon seeing his friend. It's my heart. So they're talking about Grace moving to London, and James is just acting all weird because he's like, I usually see her every summer. Not this summer, of course. I don't know, I just feel so sad for him. I don't want Matthew to be hurt. I don't want Matthew to be hurt. Okay, I need a break. Why does James not discuss Grace with anyone? Not even his parabatai. I mean, Matthew is his best friend. He should talk about Grace to him. I mean, guys do talk about girls, don't they? But yeah, James is definitely different. So Matthew knows that there is a connection between James and Grace, but he knows nothing more than that.
Why? And how could I forget this?
This reread was necessary.
I don't know why, but this is funny that Christopher says, "Oh bloody hell, Alistair Carstairs." I'm not remembering incorrectly. He's an awful pill. Question mark.
Yes! I wanted to say that I really love Alistair and Cordelia's relationship because my brother teases me just like this. Also, my cousin brothers. Like, we also have the same relationship. We have fun like that, we tease each other, and like, it feels so real the way Cassie has written their relationship. It's beautiful and fun to read about. I mean, it seems so natural. I don't care what you say, I love James Herondale, but I will not change my statement. Matthew is more handsome than James. That's it.
Cordelia says she would solve this with cleverness and bravery, not with the sale of herself as a bride. I think that's a very, very good thing, and I just really like female protagonists who have such mindsets. Lucy is adorable. I love her and Cordelia and their friendship, Lucy said. I heard a bit of their conversation this morning by accident, though. Cordelia says, accident. Cordelia raised an eyebrow. I may have been hiding beneath the table, said Lucy with dignity, but it was only because I had lost an earring and was looking for it. Cordelia suppressed a smile. Go on. I cannot explain, but I love them. They are the best girls in friendship. I mean, I love them together.
Why did Tatiana have to ask James to cut the briars? Like, what did she even have to do with James? Why? Why James? I hate it.
It's funny, I seriously forgot that Grace approached James by saying, Herondale boy? I cannot believe, why did Grace talk to him like that?
Talk about James and Matthew. They both entered the ballroom and the girls are like going crazy about them. And I'm gonna share fan art of Matthew and James. And you tell me who you would choose. I mean, I cannot choose their pair, but they're best friends. They're both my favorite characters, but I love James. And I still love Matthew more. I love Matthew more, okay? Does anyone agree with me? Do you like Matthew more than James? Just tell me that. I'm on page 68 and James and Cordelia are dancing. And I know that that scene is about to come and that James will just leave Cordelia between dancing for Grace because after Grace, he just does not remember anything. And I'm so not ready for that scene because it makes me so sad. It breaks my heart and it kind of makes me so angry at James.
You are a forest-dwelling fairy changeling. At that, he laughed. And I love the way Jesse laughs. I just love it. I love the way Lucy could hear his laughter when he left her at the manor when she met her in the forest when she was a child, and I love it now when he laughed. I can practically hear his laughter in my head, and I love the voice of it.
Okay, I'm just so happy that Grace is first described as thin as a scarecrow. Just try to smile, and no one will notice anything happen. James and I are practically interchangeable in public consciousness anyway. James left, Cordelia said. In shock. It's still so sad. I know I'm rereading, but this scene. Cordelia just said to Matthew, you are young and beautiful. And he says, men are not beautiful, men are handsome. No, boy, no. Matthew is beautiful. What is this? Men can be handsome as well as beautiful because Matthew Fairchild is the best example of it. I totally agree with Cordelia.
A scene on Will and Tessa is about to start.
She recognized Will's step in the hallway before he came into the bedroom. More than 20 years of marriage did that. This is such a mature conversation between these people. I mean, Tessa's like, we don't want our children in danger from demons, do we? And she's talking like a mother does. And then Will, he's talking like a father. We don't want them unprepared either. He wants his kids to be prepared to not only train, but also fight demons and have it in practice.
It's important. My death. My lovely wife. I wanted to say something because I cannot help but think about it. My friend told this to me. She's like, when Will and Tessa stand together and Will is going old and Tessa is not aging because she's a warlock, she couldn't help but think of them as Will of being her sugar daddy. And I laughed so hard at that. And now when I'm reading their scene, I'm so in love. I mean, I love them. I love their scenes. And it makes me emotional, but now I cannot help but think about that. Tessa says, we have been through so much, we deserve this happiness. And Will says, there are others who deserve happiness who have not gotten it. I know, a sob got in the throat. They're talking about Jem. I love Will and Tessa chapters.
We're buddy reading and we have to discuss the book while reading. And then she shared this fan art of James and Cordelia from that scene when she read to him. And I love that scene so much. I'm going to share that fan art over here and just love it.
So Cordelia was asking James for an apology
after what he did and left her at the ball. And he's like, what I did was very unforgivable, and I am trying to think of a reason you ought to forgive me anyway, because if you did not, it would break my heart. And she's like, he cleared her throat. That is a decent start. And then he's like, you've always had a very charitable nature, Daisy.
She's like, she pointed a finger at him, don't you Daisy me. And that's such a funny and lovely and, you know, light scene. I really like the way Cordelia talks. I really like her attitude. It's just brilliant. Cordelia explains to him how it is for a woman, especially when she is wearing a truly frightful gown. And James is like, I can make you a further promise as well. If I offend you again, I will wear a truly frightful gown to the next significant social gathering. And she's like, very well. We can shake on it like gentlemen do.
So on the day of the picnic, when Cordelia left James after getting apology out of him and leaving him to Grace, and that scene where Grace was asking James if he remembers something or not, I remember that was the first time that I was like, yeah, this girl is doing something, because how can James forget? How can he? He can't. And that's definitely something that this girl is doing. And then the demons come. Look at the sky. Hello everyone, it is the day after yesterday. Like, it's been 2 days since I last read. I said that I don't feel like taking a break from reading and that I was very invested in it and I was loving it. But then I went inside and my brother was making a scene and then I could not record my reactions and I did not want to act them, as I said before. I just wanted to just give you my live reactions and share my thoughts right when I'm reading the scene. So it could not happen, and yesterday the whole day I was not feeling very well and I felt like not reading much, so I did not pick book the whole day yesterday. And today in some time I'm gonna go for my haircut and get it dyed, so I don't know when and how much I will be reading and if I'll even read or not, but if I do, I'll definitely update. And it's finally sunny. It's been raining for 3 days. It was raining yesterday so much, and then I was feeling so cold. I took out my sweater and I was like, oh my god, thank god I did not put all my winter clothes inside. But today it's all sunny, you see.
So it's 3 o'clock and I decided that while I have my tea, I will read a little and share my thoughts, because after that my dad will come to pick me and I'll have to go. So let's read. Also, my hair, I just did not make my hair, because if I make my hair right now, it will be a bigger mess than it is already. Yeah, so I read this page. I've read this already. I'm just rereading this to tell you what I felt. Lucy told Cordelia, I have been told that being sought out by ghosts is not an appealing trait in a young woman. Cordelia caught at Lucy's hand with her own bandaged one. Tell me who said that to you. I will kill them. I loved the way she said it, because it just shows how good their friendship is. I don't know if it shows it to you guys or not, but it really just shows it to me, and I love it. Okay, so that's all where I had read till, and now I'm going to continue reading from, yeah, from where Christopher tried to shoot at James just to give him a shock. James is telling them all to go out of the ballroom, and he's saying that I will just take the blame on me and no one else. And then Will is demanding, answer me, James, why have you blocked this door? I demand to know what's going on. And Matthew is like, James isn't here. Go away. I don't know. That was so funny. James looked at Matthew puzzled. Really? I heard breaking glass, Will called. I was practicing fighting moves, Matthew answered. In the ballroom? We're trying to distract Thomas. It's been a very emotional day. What? I love this. So, James went into the Shadow Realm. Okay, I wanted to say this. Tessa is so nice. She handed the letter to James, and I'm hoping she did not read it because that makes me feel good about her. And if it would have been my mother, she would have read my letter and then given to me. She would not have cared about privacy. And I hate it. Okay, I don't know what the deal is, but Grace said, if I fetched you shears and you cut them back from the gates, I would keep you company. Jim said, that seems a fine bargain. And then she says, I cannot promise to make enough idle conversation to fill the time, of course. I could read to you if you like. And James is like, no, no, thank you. Why did he say no like this? I am assuming that it was because he was remembering his time with Cordelia, I think. Okay, this is so sweet. At night, he fell asleep to his memory of Cordelia's voice, low and steady in his ear. I love it. Okay, so I hate Grace's dialogue. She acts all innocent, and then there are these evil things behind her statements. I don't believe her. Even 0%. Okay, so I have to speak a little low because my sister is studying. The thing is, James assumed that did explain why Grace had only a single rune on her left hand. The Voyant's rune was the first mark Shadowhunters received when they were children. Tatiana had clearly not welcomed the idea of Grace continuing her Shadowhunter education further. This is something that he assumed. And this is something that I thought that I read about, and I was like, how can Grace act? Because if you have not read The Midnight Air, which is a short story from the Bane Chronicles, I'll write it all here that it has spoilers, but it's not like it's much. It's just that in the Bane Chronicles, Jace seemed all trained to fight. She knew how to hold a sword, and she knew how to wield it, and I just think that this thing that she is not trained, that Tatiana did not let her train or something, is just James' assumption that I was having in my mind, that James, that Grace never got trained or something. Okay, so I don't know if I'm remembering it correctly or not, but Hannah, the Clockwork Reader on BookTube, I saw her reading vlog on Chain of Gold last year. Yeah, after I read it, I watched her reading vlog on it, and she was like, if Tatiana Blackthorne is hiding something like the bracelet, then it definitely has something, some kind of power. And I honestly did not think about it that way. I was just very curious and suspicious that why is Grace like talking about bracelet, and why would Tatiana not give her a bracelet? Like, what's a bracelet got to do with anything? Why can you not give your step kid, even if it's not your kid, a bracelet? What harm could that do? And now I'm having Hannah's words ring in my head. Grace was like, Carstairs are going to visit you, and then you'll be spending all your time with them. And then James is like, no, Cordelia and Lucy are going to be peripatized, so they'll be spending all their time together. But Lucy is also writing a book, so James will have to spend time with Cordelia when Lucy is writing, just so that he's a good host and stuff. And then he says, obviously, if she wanted to spend every day with me, that would be all right. And he stopped. He realized that he had become entirely graced sometime in the past 10 seconds. I love when he thinks about Cordelia and starts babbling. It's cute. Grace says, you're You're just in love with Cordelia. James was horrified, and this is how I imagine him.
I am fond of her. Like, he's not in love, is what he wants to say. That is all. We are friends, as you and I are.
Oh, Grace said. I know, she must be expecting him to fall in love with him, and she will make him fall in love with him, but dirty Gracelet.
Grace said, and if she arrives here in Idris and tells you she has met the most wonderful men and they have had a whirlwind romance and now they are promised to each other, you would only congratulate her like you would any of your friends? Question mark. I would tell her she was too young to get married, James said. Like, he would still try to stop her from getting married. And he did when Cordelia asked him that James should help her find a guy who she could get married to, a good guy or something like that. And James was like, you cannot get married. And Cordelia was like, why not? And that happened.
I really like the book that Lucy is writing about Cruel Prince James. And it's just amazing.
So Grace gave him the idea that he could like turn into a shadow and get her bracelet for her, and James thought of it so positively. He said not only did she accept him, she presented an opportunity for his power to be used to help. He did not think of it as Grace using him for the very first thing that she could think of after seeing him do what he was capable of doing. I don't know, I would have thought of it as someone using me. That's how my mind works. And James just never thinks of anything negative about anybody, let it be Grace or anyone. Okay, so I have read till where Lucy and Cordelia get to the Blackthorn Manor and they open the gate with the opening rune, and I'm gonna have to stop over there because I have to get ready. My dad will be here anytime. Hopefully read in the car. And when I get back home. Okay, the way Grace is talking to Cordelia right now is the same way that she talked to Magnus about James in the Midnight Air, and I hate it. So Lucy asked him, what do you do during the day? And he smiled faintly. I vanish. Really? Vanish where? She said. And he said, you have a great deal of questions. And that reminds me of Will and Tessa, because Tessa used to question so much and Will used to be like, woman, do you ever get tired of questioning? Who could this blonde boy be? One of my friends on Goodreads told me that it could be Nate's ghost, and I honestly don't remember what color hair Nate had, so I don't know if he was blonde or what, but I cannot think of any blonde boy, anyone who would look familiar to Lucy. I don't know. Okay, don't get me wrong, but I like Anna Lightwood a lot. I really like her, and I really like that she is known as badass and the girl who breaks hearts all the time. And I like it, but I don't encourage this kind of behavior. Like, I just don't like that you go on about breaking people's hearts for no reason. Especially when the reason is that your heart was broken by someone. I mean, it's not their fault. Don't do it to them. Cordelia said that that girl called you sir, and that did she think that you were a man? And I was like, let people believe what they want to believe. Was that true? Did she really think that Anna was a man, or did she just pretend in front of her mother and Anna did not want to discuss the details with Cordelia? I'm confused.
Malcolm asked Cordelia, there's no Blackthorn blood in your family, is there?
No, none, I don't think, Cordelia said, surprised.
And why did Malcolm ask Cordelia that?
Okay, shit, I don't know how serious this is for you guys or not, but Matthew, drunk. And then Cordelia asked him, do you remember how I asked you about your mother at the ball? And Matthew said, I always enjoy thinking about my mother at these sorts of parties.
Oh my god, that hurt me so bad.
Have the guards take this mermaid away and put her in the wine cellar. Please reconsider putting a poisoner in the wine cellar, said Matthew. I beg of you, for the sake of my future visits. What will become of this boy?
Let the marks be stripped, James went cold all over. And I remembered that it was his grandfather, of course, Will's father, Edmund Herondale, who left being a shadow hunter just to be with a woman he loved. And now I am thinking that Edmund Herondale had blonde hair.
I mean, of course he cannot be a ghost, because if he were, then at least Will would see him. James would also see him. But Lucy saw that ghost with blonde hair and it seemed familiar to her. So I'm just thinking that it's Edmund Herondale now. I could be wrong though. So after they all fought the demons and James told the demons to go away and then they went in the name of his father, and after all of that, Grace came and she was like, I'm sorry, I don't know how to fight. She is such a liar. She knows how to fight. What a liar. What a bitch. Yeah, so we wait till Matthew Singh, Magnus Fane, my personal hero. Yes. I love all the scenes where Ragnar Fell looks at Christopher and he's like, this guy blew up the south wing of the academy. Was it the south wing? Anyway, Alistair was talking to Charles and Cordelia like followed him because she thought that Alistair would like break his promise and tell Charles about the thing with the demons. Anyways, Alistair was telling Charles, you said it would be temporary, a temporary political engagement, but I have spoken with Ariadne, Charles, and she very much believes this marriage will happen. I don't know how you say Ariadne, but I say Ariadne. Anyways, after a paragraph, he said, this is not fair to her, Charles, or to me. And I think that this is so bad. I mean, both Ariadne and Charles are not doing something fair because Ariadne broke Anna's heart and she's like engaged to Charles, and then Charles is doing the same to Alistair. And why? Why? I don't like this. Why do people keep breaking each other's heart? Why? Alistair was talking to Charles and he said, I have convinced my mother I can be of better use to the family in politics. And Charles said, you will find it difficult to succeed in politics without a wife. Ariadne is an unusual case, said Alistair. If she did not prefer women, she would be unlikely to be willing to marry you. And if it were not Ariadne, Alistair looked bewildered. Speak sense, Charles. What do you mean? Charles shook his head as if he were clearing away cobwebs. Nothing, he said. And of course, he breaks off his engagement to Ariadne. So I'm now thinking that Grace was in this whole scene already. It is Grace that he's been thinking of. How could he speak of it without having someone in mind? Jessamine said there are certain forms of necromancy that can compel them to tell the truth, them, the ghosts, and even allow the living to control them. And Lucy is living, but Lucy is not involved in any form of necromancy yet. So Cordelia was talking to Anna, and Anna was like, Charles, bloody Charles, everything in service of his ambitions. And she's so right. I cannot believe he's Henry and Charlotte's son. Like, they were so, so nice people. And what is he even doing? I'm still hurt for Anna. I still am. I know it's in another book. It's an entirely different short story. And Anna is not even enough in this book to feel much about her character, but I still feel about her. Okay, so Matthew and Lucy were talking and Lucy said something that hurt Matthew. And every time he hurts, I feel like crying. I have never felt any tenderness for anything or anyone living. Have you truly never felt anything for anyone? Matthew demanded. She was silent for a moment. My brother, she said at last, with a peculiar half smile. But then, he is not now living. So you never cared for James at all? And Grace, I cannot believe she is saying that to his spare bataille because she is so confident that James would not believe Matthew, but he would believe her. How can she? I hate it. Grace made Matthew kiss her, and then she said, if you get in my way after this, if you do anything to impede my marriage to Charles, I will tell James you kissed me, and I will tell your brother too. I hate that Grace did this. I really want to know her side of the story and understand her better, but what she's doing, I hate it. Okay, I was wondering when this happens, that scene from the Midnight Air, and then James was taking out Matthew's silver flask from his pocket. Matthew was like, are you sure? The last time you were feeling heartbroken, you took shots at a chandelier with a mundane gun and nearly drowned yourself in the serpentine. Everyone is continuously saying that it's been so long that they saw Magnus, and now Matthew is referencing that scene. Like, it already happened and Magnus is already here, but he's not here.
He isn't. This tiny detail does not make sense to me.
I am so glad that this is Matthew's quote. All pain fades, all misery passes. Humanity is drawn to light, not darkness. It suits him to say that, but it's sad.
I love this line that Cordelia says. It's one of my favorite quotes of this book. She says, "One, that's everyone's dream, isn't it really? Instead of many who give you little pieces of themselves, one who gives you everything." How beautiful is that?
So Cordelia and James were talking and Cordelia was telling him, "That's why I asked you to find a gentleman for me. I really do like tea," James shouted from the bottom of the steps. "In fact, I love it. I love tea." And he was shouting and then, "Good for you, mate," yelled the driver of a passing hansom cab. God, that was funny. I don't know if it was funny for you guys or not, but it was so funny.
I want a husband like Will, okay? I want a husband like Will. "I am going to kiss your mother now," he announced. "Free if you will, children. If not, we could play Ludo when the romance is over."
"The romance is never over," said James glumly.
I'm so glad that Anna gifted Cordelia some dresses that actually suit her.
So Charles said all portable travel is suspended, and sometime after that Will said it's quarantine. And the first time I read it last year, I was like, did Cassie just predict the quarantine over here, like in real life? That was a big coincidence.
So I love this quote, and I had no idea that it was by Magnus. And the quote is, "There is no better distraction in this world than losing oneself in books for a while." Isn't that true?
I keep reminding myself that I don't want this vlog to be long, but it's going to be long because there are so many things that I want to talk about. For example, this. Will said, "So, for some reason, you thought it was a good idea to take on a manticore demon all by yourselves." And then Jim said, "Christopher was using one of his new devices." James lied. "It's meant to pick up the traces of dark magic. We didn't think it would really come to anything. That is why we didn't summon you." And all this while, Lucy was pretending to be asleep. Will's eyebrows flew up. "All six of you showed up to the tower bridge in gear despite thinking it wouldn't come to anything?" James said, "We thought it best to be prepared. Besides, I know you did much more risky things when you were my age." "It's dreadful the way you keep throwing that in my face," said Will. That's funny. Will said, "Yes, and you should tell Christopher that the Clay wishes to use this new device of his. It seems as if it could be very useful," said Will. "Ah," said James. Tragically, the device was eaten by the demons, unable to help herself. Lucy giggled. What a family time. I love it. This was a really good scene and worth sharing.
So I know that Alistair has done very terrible things at the academy, the way he treated James, the way he bullied them, and he did not realize how it affected everyone because Matthew did a sin. He cannot forget the thing that he did. Like, he's suffering from it just because of the rumor that Alistair spread. I mean, there's so many things that Alistair did that cannot be forgotten or forgiven that easily, but at the same time, I do understand him. I mean, that boy has been going through a lot, hasn't he? Like, he didn't want to be laughed at the academy, and so he joined the bullying team and whatever. And then at the same time, in his childhood, he was protecting his sister, and he was trying to preserve her childhood and let her, like, enjoy it and respect her father the way he could not, because he knew the truth about him. And at the same time, he's also, like, trying to make things better. And we can see that Alistair has changed, because he was so different with Thomas when he met him in Paris, and the way he is with Charles, like, he's going through that as well. Charles is making him understand again and again that whatever he is doing is for both of them, but it's not easy. Alistair has been going through a lot, and as much as I hate what he did to James and all the Merry Thieves at the academy, I still feel a lot for him, and I just wish that people forgive him, but I know it will not be easy for Matthew. I'm so sad. I cannot read ahead of this. I'm gonna stop here and I'm gonna continue reading tomorrow. For now, I need a break, like a break from this book, and I'm gonna go read my Lord of Shadows. So, see you guys tomorrow.
So, Matthew told James, "If I ever catch you considering befriending Alistair James, then what?" James said, arcing an eyebrow. "Then I will have to tell you what Alistair said to me the day we left the academy, and I would rather not. Cordelia should never know it, if nothing else. She loves him, and she should be allowed that." Cordelia. James thought of her, and then he was thinking that Matthew should not suffer it in silence, but it could not happen because then Christopher came, and they went out, and they, like, the Cora demons came, and they were fighting them. But I'm like, again? Every time Matthew gets a chance to, like, talk to James about whatever he wants to talk about, it always ends up, like, disturbed. It doesn't happen. I literally forgot that Cordelia's mother was expecting, and I just read about it, and I'm like, what?
So Lucy was, like, listening to Grace talk to Jesse's dead body, and then the demon came, and the demon was telling Grace, "You should never have betrayed the oaths your mother swore to those far more powerful than she. Some enchantments are not yours to remove. Do you understand?" And Grace was telling the demon that it was not working, it was already fading, and then the demon was saying, "You will do as you are told. Put the enchantment back where it was. I, Namtar, will see to its strengthening." It's got to be the bracelet, because I remember the first time I read it, I could not even think which enchantment it could be. And even Lucy is thinking it must be the enchantments on Jesse, because she does not know about the bracelet. But since we readers know about it, I am now thinking it must be that, because that's the only enchantment that Grace has under her control. None else. So I was thinking why she goes back to James when he is finally starting to forget her. Why does she go back to him and tell him that, okay, you just be married to Cordelia for like this much time, and then I'll be married to Charles for this much time, and then we'll both leave them both and be together. So I was like, why? Why do it when he's finally starting to, like, move on from you? And then now I get it. It was the demon telling Grace, and we still are not getting Grace's point of view, so we don't know why she is forced to listen to the demon, because I don't know.
I don't care what you people say, Thomas and Alistair have the sweetest moments, even if they are like this tiny. I love their moments. So they came back from the demon realm, and James was telling Cordelia that they should read together, and Cordelia was like, "Reading together? Never had Cordelia heard of anything so romantic." And that is so romantic. That is so sweet. I wish I had a reading date. I wish that a guy ever asked me to read together. I mean, how beautiful is that? Why do guys these days never think of this? I also love every time Matthew says something, quotes something, and then James says, "Yeah, that book, that author." I love it. I wish I had friends like this who I could quote to. And I do have my friends, Lila and Alyssa and Karina, but we don't read the same books enough to quote something and then tell each other, "Oh yeah, I know what you're talking about." So I wish that time comes soon, you guys. I just love Alistair and Cordelia's sibling relationship. I adore it. It's so beautiful, and he's such a nice big brother. I've always wanted a big brother. It's okay that I don't have any, because I know that the big brothers in real life are not anything like the big brothers in the books. Not like Alistair, not like James. Oh my god, they're most definitely like Charles, yes. When Alistair said that I chose the one where I wasn't made to feel like a laughing stock, and Cordelia asked him, "And how has that worked out?" He said, "Awful." Alistair knew it was awful, that he was being awful, that what he was doing was awful, that what he was making the other person going through was awful. He knew all of it, and he still did it, which made it all the more worse for Alistair. And he's like trying to make things better, and it's not easy. I'm so sad. The burn chapter starts with something that very, very much suits or feels like dedicated to James, and it is, "My heart is bound by beauty's spell, my love is indestructible. Although I like a candle burn, and almost do a shadow turn, I envy not the heart that's free, love's soul encircling chains for me." That's so true. That's so like James. Grace came to James before he had to read with Cordelia, and then she said that, yeah, you get married to Cordelia, I will get married to Charles, and then we will like leave them both and be together. That's what I remembered. I literally forgot this. Grace told James that I intend to remain away from home until my marriage. I saw my mother there, and at first I thought I had been successful. She seemed pleased I had made a powerful match. Then I realized she had lost interest in what I had done because she had larger plans. This larger plans line is what I literally forgot. This might come as a surprise, but it is a surprise to me that Grace is telling James everything. Like, she's telling him the truth. That her mother is furious that James caught Jesse's last breath and that now Jesse might never come back. And she's telling him about all the necromancy and stuff. Grace is telling him, remember that automaton in the hallway of the manor in Idris? James was like, yes, what's that got to do with anything? And she's like, it was inspelled by a warlock years ago in the event of her death. It is enchanted to rise up and kill Shadowhunters. I honestly do not remember Grace telling James all of this, and I'm even now thinking that she is tricking him, like, this is not the truth, though it can be, because Tatiana can go to any extent. And then she told him that how the automaton will, like, rise after Tatiana dies, and then it will kill Shadowhunters, and that Tatiana has decided to kill herself today because she has nothing to live for since her son can no longer be brought back. James tells her that, yeah, we should go to my parents, tell them all this information, and Grace is like, no, no one must know, James. If the Glaive arrests my mother, if they search Blackthorn Manor, they will see how deeply my mother has sunk into necromancy and black magic, and I will be at fault as well. And Jessie. If she knew I had given away her secrets, Mama would want me to be blamed, James. I could be locked in Silent City. That need not happen. This is Tatiana's sin, not yours. James, she said, I'm so sorry. Sorry, he echoed. For what? I never wanted to do this to you, but she insisted, and he insisted. It had to be you. My mother made me her blade to cut every barrier raised against her, but your blood, his blood, is a barrier I cannot cut. His is Belial. His is Belial, isn't it? And James is not even questioning what she is talking about. Who he? Who? And I cannot bind you without this chain, Grace says. And then something silver flashed in her hand. He tried to pull away, but she held fast. Grace told him the truth and then put it on him. I don't remember this. All I remembered was that James, like, listened to Grace and then put on the bracelet himself willingly. But reading this, I'm like, what did I even read the first time? Like, this was not in my mind. He tried to pull away, but she held fast. Now there's a cloud on James. Like, he's now influenced again. He can only remember things that Belial wants him to remember. And only the way he wants him to remember. I hate Belial so much, and I hate Grace for doing all of this. I mean, I know that she tried to tell him the truth, but in the end, she did what her mother wanted her to do, what that demon told her to do, to put the enchantment back, and she did. Is Grace a coward, or is there any other reason to justify all of this? Because I know that she definitely does have a redemption arc, and I don't want to hate her because I don't know her side of the story, but this is, I hate it. I am so hurt. I am so, so hurt. I cannot tell you guys. Cordelia had not seen Grace together with James since the fight at Battersea Bridge. She had not thought it would hurt like this, and it's hurting me just as much. I am feeling it for Cordelia. And then she had prepared carefully for this long-awaited visit. She had picked out one of her favorite new dresses in bright blue. She had worn her nicest gold earbobs, and she had brought with her a translated copy of Lala and Majnu. It was not as beautiful in English as it was in the original Persian, but it would be perfect for reading with James. Now, as she stared at James and Grace, she was glad the book was hidden inside her jacket. Oh my god! Oh my god! This is hurting me so, so bad. I realized I was screaming. I don't like this. I don't like this. Okay, so here's another quote by Cordelia that I absolutely love, and I wish that it made Matthew feel better, but here it is. You decide the truth about yourself. no one else, and the choice about what kind of person you will be is yours alone. Matthew stared at her for once, it seemed, speechless. This little moment, this little conversation between Cordelia and Matthew, I am so glad for it. I'm so happy. I really want Matthew and Cordelia to share this friendship. I feel like crying. I cannot stop myself. So they were all thinking of reasons given the council meeting after burning the Blackthorn Manor, and Thomas was like, just don't say anything. Yeah, an evil house full of dark magic items will have been destroyed along with the dangerous automaton. I would strongly urge you not to say anything. And then Matthew looked startled. Really? Our true Thomas, who so often counsels honesty. Thomas shrugged, and then they were just having a conversation, and Thomas raised his glass to being secret heroes, and then Matthew said to standing by each other no matter what. This is a moment of pure happiness, and I am so glad for it. I love it, especially after all that has been happening before. Oh my god, I literally forgot what a drama queen Tatiana is and what a story maker she is. She's like, he conspired with the enemy. I have been collecting evidence of his plots. And when Will demanded the evidence, she's like, it was in my house in Idris. I gathered it all. But then this boy, this demon spawn, burned my house to the ground. Why else would he do that? Save to protect his secret? What a bitchy story maker she is. Ugh, I hate Tatiana. You know, I once felt very bad for her that Will actually embarrassed her in front of so many people reading her diary or whatever it was, but now I'm like, she deserved every bad thing done to her. I still want to read Grace's side of the story, but I don't care about Tatiana's side of the story. I mean, oh, by the way, I just realized I wanted to talk to you guys. Don't you think Tatiana's husband who died had cousins or brothers or anyone? It surely can't be that her husband was the only Blackthorn, and that Jesse was the only Blackthorn, and that the Blackthorn line cannot be gone forward after this. There have got to be more Blackthorns. Cassie Clear, too, is a drama lover because she did not have to, like, make Cordelia say the dialogue that James was with her in her bedroom all night. Cassie could have written that James was with any of the Merry Thieves, that you could say that he was with us, or the friends could all say that they were out. Anything, but no, it had to be Cordelia because Cassie Clare wants drama, and the family tree that people have been looking for ages, which I did not know about because I had only read The Mortal Instruments and The Dark Artifices until like 2019. I only read The Infernal Devices and all the other Shadowhunter Chronicle books last year, so I did not even know much about the family trees. And Cassie just had to justify her family tree because in the family tree, Cordelia and James get married, and what a drama. I remember Hannah, the Clockwork Reader, in her vlog was like, I did not expect them to get married like this. This is not the marriage that she was looking forward to. And I'm like, well, that's Cassie Clare. She gives you something to hold on to, and then she gives you something which tells you that, oh, you were holding on to something for nothing. I don't even know how I will keep myself together reading Chain of Iron. I don't know, I cannot help it. The way Tatiana screamed that it has got to be one of the Merry Thieves, Christopher Lightwood, Thomas Lightwood, or Matthew Fairchild, the way she was screaming, I could not help but laugh because, you know, she's screaming like a cartoon witch. That's so funny. This is the part where I truly feel sad for Tatiana because she's like, Grace, why won't you help me? And like, she shrieked and crumpled to the floor. And everyone is saying that, yeah, Magnus is even saying that she tried to hire me in January. And I saw a lot of necromantic magic over there, which is also called black magic and stuff. Like, they're all over Tatiana. And of course she deserves it because she is being a bad bitch. And all of that, but I still feel for her. Like, she lost her son, she lost her husband, and she had nobody, and she wanted to raise him. I mean, spoilers for The Dark Artifices, mute it till you see the spoiler warning, but Malcolm was bad, he was committing murders, everybody hated him, but I felt for him too, because he went through so much to raise Annabelle, and then Di did the same. He tried to raise Livy, and so many sad things are happening. That's it. That's all I wanted to say about the Dark Artifices. Cassie! Why? Why? James is telling Cordelia, let's go back now and tell them I did it. I burned down the house and you were lying to shield me. Why couldn't James suggest that you go back and you say that you lied because you had confidence that I had not done it and you were trying to shield me? You said it because you had faith in me. Why is James like, I have to tell them that I did it? And why, Cassie? Why? Why is such a drama? Why do this to us? James asked her, Daisy, will you marry me? My... The world seemed to stop. She thought of the clocks in the Blackthorn Manor all frozen at 20 to 9. She thought of the 1,000 times she had imagined James saying these words, but never under these circumstances. Never like this. James, she said, you don't love me. No, he said. I don't. He does. He loves Cordelia. He loves her. And because of the bracelet, he's thinking that he loves Grace. Not in that way. And you don't love me that way either, James continued. But we are friends, aren't we? He said. You are one of the best friends I've ever had. I will not leave you in trouble alone. She loves you. And you... James keeps calling her friends. They're not friends. Not just friends. You love Grace, Cordelia whispered. Don't you? Grace is marrying someone else, James said. I am perfectly free to marry you. I do not want a situation in which my husband is unfaithful to me, Cordelia said. I will not marry you and turn some blind eye to whatever you do, James. I would rather be alone and scorned, and you would rather be free. Daisy, James said. I would never, ever do that to you. When I make a promise, I keep it. I read a post by Cassie Clare, and it said, it was like a line from Jane of Iron, and it was that, I kissed Grace today. And people were all making theories about who could have said it, and I, for one, thought, it must be Matthew telling James that he kissed Grace, but then it was, I kissed Grace today. It was not sometime in the past, and so I thought it must be James. He hurt Cordelia, and Cordelia doesn't deserve it. Persian is so much like Urdu. I mean, of course, Urdu is derived from different languages, but there are so many similarities that I think that I did not notice the first time. Like, so many words, even before, I did not talk about it, but now I cannot help it. Like, Shay Kar Kardi, and it means, what have you done? And Kardi is like, it's a similar word to a word in Urdu, Kardiya. The way Alistair talked to Cordelia and asked her if she was happy, and after she asked him if he was happy, and the way they talked, their conversation, the bond that they share, it's precious. Let no one who loves be called altogether unhappy. Even love unreturned has its rainbow. I love these words. Grace just told James that she could be with him in a year, a long engagement with Charles, and he could divorce Cordelia, and then they could be together. I'm just sad. I don't know if you guys agree with me or not, but I really think that whether Cassie learns or matures in writing or not, she certainly has a degree in writing heartbreaking books, because that's what she does. Every time I start a Cassie Clare book, I have to tell myself, even through a reread, I have to brace myself, because I am bound to get my heart broken. Anna was just thinking how suspicious it is for James and Cordelia to get engaged, and I just like Anna, and I like it so much that she's so observant. I am so glad to read this. I remembered that there was a scene where Anna observed everything and then Ariadne comes to her, but I forgot this, and it makes me so happy to read it that I want to share it with you guys. There were many things Anna knew she excelled at, and one of them was being a judge of character. Cordelia Carstairs, who blushed at the sight of a seductive gown, was not going to spend the night with a man she was not married to, even if he was the love of her life. Nor would James compromise an unmarried girl. That's how much faith she has in both of them, even though she does not know Cordelia that much, and because she knows James. I love Anna. I am so happy about this conversation between Anna and Ariadne. She said, "You have made quite a name for yourself, Anna, as someone who does not believe in love." And Anna spoke coldly. "Indeed, I think that romantic love is the cause of all the pain and suffering in this world." "Well, that is true, but not quite true, because it's not only romantic love that hurts. Sometimes friendships, when they're broken and friends leave you, it hurts too. It hurts a lot." Ariadne says, "I know you are strong-willed, Anna Lightfoot, but I am just as strong-willed. I will change your mind. I will win you back. And I hope she does. Because I really want Anna to be happy. And I have no idea why I feel like crying right now, but I am also going to be strong-willed. I am not going to cry." "I love the way Will said to Cordelia, 'I loved my father when I was a child. I thought he was the best man I'd ever known. Then when I discovered he had squandered all our money at the gaming tables, I thought he was the worst man I'd ever known. Now that I am myself a father, I know that he was simply a man.'" Such simple lines and so much beauty in them. I am going to cry. I cannot help it. Cordelia was just thinking that Will must have noticed that James has not even come to her at their engagement party. And just when she thought it, James said, "Daisy. Daisy," he said again, shyly. And Cordelia barely noticed Will step away from her. "Would you like to dance?"
If it were me,
I would have cried when he asked me that. So, Alistair just came to Lucy, Matthew, and Thomas, and I'm so nervous already to read this scene because Matthew was about to tell Thomas what Alistair said the day he left the academy. Alistair said, "Can we not put our school days behind us? If I admit I was a cad, is that enough? How can I apologize?" "You cannot," said Matthew, his voice very strange, and they all looked at him. "Do not think you are our friend now, or welcome among us, regardless of all that has happened," said Matthew. "Let him say what he wants to say, Thomas." Alistair said that, and now Matthew was going to say it. "You have no right to talk to Thomas in that familiar way." "I never told this to you, Thomas. I couldn't bear to, but better that you know the truth than that you allow the snake to befriend you." "Matthew," Thomas began impatiently, "do you know what he used to say at school?" Matthew said, "That my mother and your father were lovers, that I was your father's bastard. He told me that Henry was only half a man and couldn't father children, and therefore Gideon had stepped into the breach. He said that your mother was so hideously ugly because of a scarred face that no one could blame your father for looking elsewhere, and that you were a sickly, ugly little thing because you had inherited her weaknesses of constitution because she had been a mundane, but not just a mundane, a servant and a whore." Matthew stopped on a sort of gasp as if he could not quite believe what he had just said. Thomas looked stock still, the color draining from his face. Alistair had not moved either. It was Lucy who said, to her own surprise, "He was the source of that awful rumor?" "Alistair?" Not the source," Alistair said. "And I did not say all of those things to Matthew, but you did say them to others. I have heard all about it in the years since. Yes, I did spread the story. I repeated those words. I did do that." He turned to Thomas. "I am. Don't say you are sorry." Thomas's lips were gray. "You think I have not heard that tale? Of course I have. Though Matthew may have tried to protect me, I have heard my mother weep over it, my father incoherent with rage and sorrow, my sisters crushed with shame over lies." He broke off, breathless. "You repeated those words without knowing or caring if they were true? How could you? You guys must have been bored listening to me, but this scene is so awful and so heartbreaking, so sad." "They were just words," said Alistair. "I did not think."
You are not who I thought you were, Thomas said, each word cold and sharp. Matthew is right. This is your sister's engagement party, and for Cordelia's sake, we will mind her manners toward you, Carstairs, but if you come near me or speak to me at any point after this, I will knock you into the Thames.
I really wish for Alistair to be forgiven, and for Matthew to share his burden of what he did with his friends. I'm so sad.
I am so glad that Lucy went after Alistair. Alistair, wait, she cried. He spun around to look at her, and she realized to her shock that he had been crying. In a strange way, she was reminded of the first time she had ever seen a man cry. The day her father had found out his parents were dead.
What do you want? Alistair said.
You can't leave. What? He sneered. Don't you hate me too? It doesn't matter what I think. This is Cordelia's engagement party. You are her brother. It will break her heart if you vanish, and so I say you will not go. Tell Leila. Tell Cordelia that I have a bad headache and I am resting in our carriage. There is no need for her to rush or spoil her evening.
The thing I love about Magnus is that he always wants to help people who need help, but never admit that they do. For example, he wants to help Matthew Fairchild. He also wanted to help James in The Midnight Air. He helped Julian. He always helps everybody, not just Shadowhunters in their wars and stuff. Like, he helps people as a friend. He gives them a life. I love Magnus. My love for him is immense. I've never read about a character whom I love so much. But the real question was, he, Magnus, thought, why no one else seemed to notice that Matthew was only standing up because the wall was holding him. Nobody pays attention to Matthew, and that is my biggest complaint. James notices stuff about Matthew, and he tries to ask him, but I don't know, Matthew deserves attention and Matthew deserves to share his burden, and he doesn't. I have not read Romeo and Juliet, and, well, this makes me sad. Magnus thought he recalled James having muttered about some other girl to him the first time they'd met, but Romeo himself had once thought himself in love with a girl named Rosalind. It was clear from the way James and Cordelia looked at each other that this was a love match. I see why my waistcoats cannot hold your attention, Fairchild. I've been where you are. Wanting what you can't have will only rip your heart apart. Matthew spoke in a low voice. It would be one thing if James loved her. I would go into the quiet dark like Jim did and never speak of her again. But he doesn't love her. What? Magnus was unpleasantly startled. This is a false marriage, said Matthew. It's only for a year. Magnus tucked the information away as a mystery to be solved. It did not go along with what he knew of the Herondales, father or son. And yet, during that year, they are man and wife. Matthew looked up, his green eyes flashing. And during that year, I will do nothing. What kind of person do you think I am? I don't know, a lot of people think that Matthew is in love with Cordelia. The first time I read Chain of Gold, I thought that Matthew was in love with Cordelia, but then I read this thread on Twitter, which is also on Instagram. I will share both the links in the description bar below, that people also think that Matthew is not in love with Cordelia, but in love with his parabatai, James. And a lot of people have also said that there is fan art of Matthew and Lucy in the later time where they both don't have marks on their skin, and it's because they get stripped of their marks because of the things that they have done. I can understand that Lucy might have gone through that because she definitely involves herself in necromancy to raise Jesse back from the dead. But in Matthew's case, it only makes sense if he truly were in love with his parabatai, because it's not allowed.
I am not sure. I still don't know. I still feel that he is in love with Cordelia. But then he never had enough conversation with Cordelia. He never spent enough time with her. They both don't know each other. Cordelia clearly loves James. And even if Matthew does love her, I don't know where that will go. I have no theories about it. I read it the last year. And since then, I have not been able to come up with anything. If you had some theories, please don't spoil me with Jane O'Brien. I'm telling you again, please don't. Don't comment about it. But if you have any theories, or if you had any theories before Jane O'Brien, only having read Jane of Gold, do share with me what you thought about this. When Matthew said, it would be one thing if James loved her, I would go into the quiet dark like Jim did and never speak of her again. But he doesn't love her. She loved James. She always would. So many people loved without hope of return, without the dream of a touch or a glance from the object of their affection. They pined away in silence and misery, were like mortals starving for fairy fruit. This is one of the saddest paragraphs to end a book that Cassie has written, in my opinion. What fate was offering her now was a year of such fruit for her table. A year of living with James and loving him might ruin her for any other love, but oh, at least she would blaze up in glory. For a year she would share his life. They would walk together, read together, eat together, and live together. They would laugh together. For a year she would stand close to the fire and know what it was like to burn. That line had me. I don't know what Tatiana was thinking. Like, if James had worn the bracelet when he went into the realm, do you think that Belial would have influenced him to, like, be willing to give him his body? I don't know. And if that happened, if Belial actually took that body, possessed it, and came to Earth, what would have happened? I mean, destruction, total destruction. And why would Tatiana want that? She's a human being, at least. If she does not want to, like, admit that she is Nephilim, at least she is a human who lives on that same planet, in that world. Like, why would she want it? I don't get Tatiana Blackthorne's whatever she wants. I don't get what she wants. Tatiana is as complex as Grace. Tatiana is so evil, and I don't know, in the TV show, if you have not watched it, then there will be spoilers. So in the TV show, what happens is that there is one of the Iron Sisters who is like a former part of the Circle of Valentines, and so, like, this, the Adamant Citadel is corrupted because there is corruption inside it because of an Iron Sister. And I think that Cassie got that idea from the TV show, and now she's using it, because Tatiana, being an Iron Sister, being in the Adamant Citadel, she can do anything. She can weaken the weapons, or she could just, you know, she could do anything. I have read the epilogue, and I really need to read A Fairy Tale of London. I really need to read about Will and Tessa to lighten up my mood, because I cannot handle this. Hello. Thank you everyone for watching this hour-long video, which, by the way, after watching, you don't want to hear me talking anymore. But there's still some stuff that I wanted to talk about. I wanted to tell that I rated this book 5 stars. And that I love every character in this book. Honestly, before this book, before Jane of Gold, I thought that Lady Midnight was Cassie's best book in terms of introducing us to the characters and setting a really good plot. But in this book, I wanted to say that Cassie did a really good job at creating such a beautiful story. Like, she already introduced us the characters in the short stories that she wrote, and then of course the novella that she wrote, The Penultimate Hours, she, like, gave us a brief introduction about them and what sort of relationship all of them have with each other and what they feel about one another. I really appreciated the days past chapters that Cassie wrote. They really helped, and I think that it was amazing. They were short and they were so well done.
nothing felt like there should have been more. So first of all, I want to talk about Will and Tessa. I am so happy to read about them. So happy. I cannot believe that I was this happy, and I am so looking forward to read more about them and Jane Viren. I really am. I love James a lot. I love him so much, and it's so heartbreaking and so hurting that he loves Cordelia and Cordelia loves him, and he keeps calling Cordelia his friend, just a friend, and he keeps hurting her, and he doesn't even know that he's hurting her, and he's got a cloud on his head, and just imagine how hurt he is going to be, how much guilt he's going to feel when he realizes that he was under the influence of the bracelet and that he actually loves the girl that he's been hurting all this time and telling her that he does not love her. What if Cordelia is so convinced of James not loving her that when he finally does confess his love, she doesn't believe him or takes time to believe it? I love all Shadowhunter drama. All of it. Except a few things. There was something in The Dark Artifices, and there's something again in this book. And Essie, why do you not let the characters communicate? Why is there always a lack of communication between all of them? And why do they all always keep secrets? You know, these characters always keep secrets just to protect one another. Like, sometimes they're keeping a secret to not burden the other person with the knowledge of something, or sometimes they're keeping a secret when they don't want the other person to be hurt and they want to bear the hurt alone. Like, in any way, all the time, their main reasons are always that they are not, like, burdening the other person and always just protecting the other person, and that they just want to solve everything all alone. Better take all the hurt than hurt the other person that you love. And that's too much. Moving on to Matthew Fairchild. I love that boy. And the last year when I read Chain of Gold, I had not read these stories. And I reread those stories right before reading Chain of Gold. And I felt so many emotions for Matthew Fairchild. Every time he gave a hint at remembering his mother or his sin or what he did or what Alistair spread. You cannot imagine how hurt I feel. And comes Christopher and Thomas Lightwood. Like, they're both gonna be together for me because I love Christopher. I really like how he's so invested in his science, like Henry. It's cool. And the thing that he got into science because of Jesse Blackthorne's death, that was so good. And Thomas being so kind and nice and giving Alistair a second chance and then getting to know what he spread, and so much hurt. I really love the friendships in this book. I love the friendship between the Merry Thieves. I love the friendship between Cordelia and Lucy. I love the friendship between Cordelia and James. And don't call it friendship. Don't call it friendship. It's not friendship. It's love. I think that we deserve to get Jesse's point of view. I really want to know Jesse's point of view. Want to read through his head how he felt when he first met Lucy, what he thought about her when he met her in between, like, times whenever he visited her. And I really wanted Grace's point of view, which I'm so glad about, because I'm so sure Cassie definitely said it somewhere that in Chain of Iron we get a lot of Grace's point of view, so I'm so glad for that. I also think that Tatiana Blackthorne deserves her POV, because I do not get why she is so burning in hatred. What is the point of it? I mean, yes, I get it that your son died and you wanted to raise him, and so you allied with a demon, a greater demon, a prince of hell kind of demon, but I don't get the deal with hating Shadowhunter so much that you want to just eradicate the whole race. You want to eradicate all of them, like kill them, end them. Why? Why? I don't get Tatiana's hatred. It's beyond me. I really want Matthew to like share what he did with one of his friends. I'm like, it's eating me inside that he's bearing it all alone. And Lucy is going to resurrect Jesse. A Blackthorn involved in necromancy. Do let me know why this happened, but Belial had possessed all the injured people who were in the Silent City, and they were chanting James' name again and again, and Christopher was not doing that. Why not Christopher? Why spare him from the chanting when everyone was doing it? Christopher must have done it too, right? Oh, and I also read Clockwork Angel and Clockwork Prince in January. Honestly, do not remember if there were fire messages between Shadowhunters in those books, so I wanted to note if there were fire messages in the Infernal Devices between Shadowhunters or not, because I remember there were fire messages and they were most probably sent through Warlocks. So if there were any fire messages in the Infernal Devices, then what Christopher was doing trying to send a message with the help of fire runes was nothing. But if there weren't any fire messages in the Infernal Devices, then Christopher definitely invented it for the Shadowhunters, and I'm so glad for it. Anyways, I really want more Anna Lightwood. I think that there wasn't enough Anna Lightwood in this book, and that she deserved to be in this book, but it's okay. It was the first book, and Cassie had to like set up everything for the base of something bigger, and I'm hoping that there will be more Anna Lightwood in the next book. I just really want point of views from Jesse, Grace, Tatiana, Anna, Christopher. Alistair! Oh my god! I love him. I love him so much. I know what he did is unforgivable, especially for Matthew, but I love him. And I really want something to happen that makes Matthew forgive him and make things fine. Like, please. Please. Also, in The Midnight Air, Tatiana asked Magnus Bane to, like, kill 5 Shadowhunters because she wanted to raise Jesse, and that was part of it. Just like, spoilers for The Darker Devices, Malcolm did for Annabelle, the Hand of Glory or something. He killed 13 people, but 5 of them, I'm sure, were Shadowhunters. Spoilers ended. Now that Grace and Lucy are together in, you know, like, wanting to resurrect Jesse and bringing him back to life, they are going to kill 5 Shadowhunters? Or they are going to get it done by someone else? I don't know. I cannot even think about anything. It's been a year I read this book, and since then, I have not been able to make any theories, and now Cassie, like, gave out the letters, which, by the way, I still have not read because I did not want to read them, like, in between. I wanted to read things in sequence, so I'll read it before Chain of Iron, and Cassie also was, like, sharing different lines from Chain of Iron. One of them was, "I kissed Grace today." One of them was a letter or something from Annabelle Blackthorn. Don't worry, I'm not gonna waste your time and make this video longer by talking about Annabelle Blackthorn and Lord of Shadows. I will probably do it in my March wrap-up if I make a video on it, because I've only read 2 books in March. And yeah, that is it. I hope you guys enjoyed this enough to wait for my Chain of Iron reading vlog and watch that too. If you want to talk about anything, kindly comment down below. I would love to discuss stuff with you guys, and yeah, that's it. Take care and goodbye.